therapy, diagnostic, prevention, and overall understanding. I think all those things AI will help us drive much more quickly.
Hi, I'm Lidia Fonseca, Chief Digital and Technology Officer at Pfizer. In an increasingly complex digital world, it's knowledge that drives progress. That's why I am so excited to speak with my guest, Dr. Sue Desmond-Hellmann, about the impact of the accelerating renaissance we're experiencing in health and science. So, let's dive in to the power of knowing. So Sue, it's so nice to see you.
It's nice to see you too.
Dr. Desmond-Hellmann is a renowned oncologist, scientist, and former CEO of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. She served as Chancellor of the University of California at San Francisco. She's currently on the board of Pfizer and OpenAI and is a former board member of Meta. Sue has dedicated her career to using innovative solutions to improve health outcomes globally.
Literally down the street from where you and I are standing, I spent 14 years at Genentech and learned to be a real drug developer, learned how to solve problems that patients have, and then went back to UC San Francisco as chancellor to lead the university, and then finally went to Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation as CEO and got to lead what their hopes and dreams are as philanthropists to assure that everyone has a chance at a healthy and productive life.
And I think it's an aspiration for any of us who have been in healthcare, which is, how do we make sure that people live healthier, longer lives? So Sue, we are in the Bay Area, your home base. It's also the home of Silicon Valley. Many think of it as the epicenter for technology innovation. What was your aha moment where you realized the potential of AI?
I was multitasking like we all do, and I needed a job description.
You start cutting and pasting pieces here and there.
I had nothing to cut and paste. And so I went to ChatGPT and I thought, well, you know, this seems weird, but I'm just gonna put a couple of little prompts and see what I get. Unbelievable. I just could not believe I had one edit and it was ready to go. The other thing I love about AI is how much I'm learning how to use it and how it makes me think more logically and organize what I'm trying to do more thoughtfully so that I'm even more efficient. That's a really powerful thing.
And that is powerful because I think people worry that AI is going to, you know, take their place, but I actually think it amplifies us. Sue, you've had a diverse career both inside and outside of healthcare. What lessons have you learned about innovation in these fields, from clinics in the Global South to the House of Power in Washington, D.C.? Are there common themes? Are there tactics and roadblocks that you can share with us?
The one thing I am sure of is that innovation is inspiring. I'm inspired by innovation, and I think that's a universal feeling, especially if you care about health. Innovation has this promise that things will be better.
How can AI advance the field of cancer treatment in the next decade and beyond?
AI can help us understand better something that has been an observation. Some forms of cancer, like colon cancer, are turning up in patients who seem younger than your average patient with colon cancer. So we need to really understand that. So interrogating where that is, who those patients are, what they have in common. So all of that epidemiologic work, that assessment of why, will be faster. Then once somebody's diagnosed, the ability to know everything about their cancer, that we should be able to, if they've got any molecular abnormality that's driving their cancer growth that we could turn down with agents, we should know that. Agents that are on the shelf and agents that we need on the shelf. So it can be also used for drug development. I think really, really super important. And then resistance in cancer medicine, as you know, resistance is such an important issue. I would love to have the ability to take all the data, let's say for breast cancer, on certain kinds of breast cancer, and when patients relapse, what does that look like? What do they all have in common? What remedy do we need that can treat that? When we have these ideas for medicines based on these targets, the medicinal chemistry and everything that Pfizer and other companies do to make those new medicines, AI will help us drive much more quickly. So therapy, diagnostic, prevention, and overall understanding, I think all those things, we should be able to do faster, better, smarter.
Pfizer has been leveraging digital and AI across every aspect of our business, helping us to deliver a COVID vaccine and oral treatment in record time. We're building on this momentum to accelerate our next breakthrough moment to achieve with cancer what we were able to achieve with COVID. Pfizer aims to double the number of patients treated with our cancer medicines by 2030. Our AI-powered OncoScout platform helps our scientists prioritize which cancer drug targets to pursue, quickly narrowing the focus to compounds with the highest chances of becoming effective medicines.
Well, you're on the board of OpenAI, a company which in many ways brought the AI revolution to the masses. But technological adoption, specifically when trying to reach vulnerable patient populations, as you know, requires broad and deliberate collaboration. Can you share with us an example of when you have seen this type of collaboration work well, and what were the benefits?
If I go way back to the early days of working on breast cancer, the ability to know that a patient had HER2-positive breast cancer or HER2-negative breast cancer helped us understand the best therapy to give patients. So that meant that there needed to be data sharing. These were all parts of a system that required change, and particularly the issue of patient privacy, which led to HIPAA and other things over the time that we've been studying targeted therapy. I think there'll be something in, especially in the medical and scientific kind of connections that OpenAI is making, where we already have some resources. We have HIPAA, we have genetic privacy, we have a lot of things that will serve us well as we're thinking about how to use AI. But I'll give you an example where we don't quite have it ready yet. Who owns the electronic health record? Mm. If you could access the electronic health record of millions and millions and millions of patients and utilize that for an AI-driven hypothesis or test a hypothesis, that would be incredibly powerful. So I predict that in addition to copyright fights, which are very public and visible, they'll just be data discussions on who owns the data, who benefits if there's a commercial value to the data, and who protects the people who the data belongs to.
We recently shared results from the Breakwater trial showing that our BRAF-TOBI combination therapy cut the risk of death in half for patients with BRAF, V600, E-mutant, metastatic colorectal cancer. It marks a major step forward for patients facing one of the toughest forms of colon cancer.
What I'm seeing so clearly with the discussions at OpenAI and other AI companies, I want all this power to be brought to bear, as I know you do, on, like, we got problems to solve. And so the push and pull is speed and protection. And that's why the regulatory framework for doing this is so important.
We have so much knowledge that we have accumulated over decades and decades. We need to be able to liberate that data so that it can actually improve our lives. But we also do need to be mindful about how do we protect privacy? How do we ensure that we use it responsibly and make sure that there's a transparency to it, but then there's also a protection of it. I want to stay with adoption for a second. You were also on the board of Meta. You have helped shepherd two companies that have seen their products spread like wildfire. What do you think drove that rapid adoption? And what lessons can other industries learn
You saw a few weeks ago when OpenAI released on ChatGPT some of this thing about how you could turn a photo into something else, and people love that. So I think that that's what these technologies all have in common. They sort of bring you in and engage you, and then you share them. Because what was interesting about some of the images I mentioned is people shared them quickly on social media. So it's sort of the AI's adoption is being elevated by sharing.
10 years ago, Sue, a computer science degree was considered the hot degree. Now, those same developers are often concerned about the advances in coding through AI and the impact on their jobs. If you were still a university chancellor today, what advice would you give to students about picking a future-proof career, just given the fast pace of change?
I do think that computer science will remain a diploma that people will respect and do respect. I think it's more important to learn how to learn. If I think about when I graduated from medical school and today, things have changed so much. I've had to learn so much since then that was getting an MD was a start of something, not the end of something. The computer science should be the start of something. Learning how to learn, having a construct, almost like you've got a scaffold, and that the rest of your life you'll build on that scaffold.
I love this image that you put forward about a scaffold, because it is. It is. You keep adding more ingredients to who you are as a leader, to who you are as an expert. And I think the more you do that, not only are you having more fun, but I think you also have a lot more impact as well. We've already seen so much a digital transformation in healthcare, from telehealth and wearables to AI accelerating drug discovery, to health-focused consumer experiences and more. Are there any particular advancements that you're most excited about?
People are increasingly reading a lot and interested in driving their own health. What are the ways that people can drive their own health and get reliable information, take more control over their own path, and have more reliable health information? I would love to see, whether it's social media, AI, communication expertise being applied to that. We will need that. We have an aging population, and helping Americans have healthy and productive lives that they drive themselves, I think, is exciting. I can learn how to change my bike tire on YouTube, but I can't figure out, you know, how I stay healthy in ways that are curated enough for me to believe it.
This is precisely why we created Health Answers by Pfizer, an experience that provides up-to-date, relevant answers to consumers' health and wellness questions. Unlike other generative AI products, Health Answers by Pfizer delivers objective insights from trusted third-party sources like Harvard Health Publishing, Doctorpedia, the NIH, and CDC. Health Answers does not stop at information. It offers relevant articles to learn more, suggests next steps to take, and even connects you with specialists when you need expert assistance. These new tools also bring with them new risks, and we need to be thoughtful about them, right? What ethical considerations should be prioritized in your mind when deploying AI in healthcare? And is there anything that gives you pause?
It's privacy, confidentiality, first do no harm. And then I just think that integrity. There's a term that FDA uses that I really like because it's very clear, a claim. A claim is when you say, my drug does X, that's a claim. And you have to prove that. So if I claim I'm gonna keep you alive for another 10 years, I need to back that up. When it comes to claims, if you wanna compete out there on the health and longevity and all this, you can't compete without saying things, and often those claims are pretty flimsy and haven't been reviewed by anybody. And I don't think most consumers are trained to look at that. So I think that's a big risk.
Let's finish with a broad question. You've devoted your life to improving the human condition. After all is said and done, where do you believe AI can improve our lives in the future?
In many, many ways. AI can help us achieve tasks that are mundane, that won't have to trouble us. It will help us make scientific and technical advances faster and better than we did before. And that will change everything from health to climate change remedies. Life will be better for people as a result of AI. And we will need to make sure it's better, think about job displacement and safety to achieve those goals without bad side effects.
Well said. And I think when we think about where the future of work is going, it's going to be about what are the skills, because there will be different mindsets required to work with AI and agentic AI. I think it will amplify. It will amplify us. It will help us, like you say, address the menial tasks so that we can focus on more higher, you know, strategic goals and tasks. But we need to be prepared to skill and make sure that everybody's ready for it.
Totally
so thank
agree.
You so much.
Oh,
wonderful
thank you. I've enjoyed talking to you. Thank you.
Thank you for tuning in to our series, The Power of Knowing, with Dr. Sue Desmond-Hellmann. In this episode, we discussed how AI is transforming health outcomes by enhancing disease identification, enabling personalized treatment, and accelerating drug development. We learned that AI can help us understand why certain cancers, like colon cancer, are appearing in younger patients, speeding up epidemiological work and diagnosis, while also helping us to create personalized treatments by targeting the main causes of cancer growth with the right medicines. Another point we touched on is that collaboration and data sharing are key to moving medical research forward. This new era of AI will require strong policies and flexible systems that let us share data in a safe, anonymous way so we can learn from it while still protecting patients' privacy. This will help us deliver better health outcomes for patients. As an example, helping us to understand what type of cancer a person has and treating it with the right medicine. We discussed how essential it is to build and maintain trust with both patients and the public, particularly with the abundance of information that is available to us today. That trust depends on ensuring health claims are grounded in rigorous, well-validated research and data. It also means helping people interpret those claims by presenting clear, credible information from trusted sources. Being a student is tougher than ever, given just how much opportunity and uncertainty we face. What will be the jobs of tomorrow? We just don't know. That's why the most important thing you can take from school right now is the skill of learning itself. And from her experience as a chancellor of UCSF, Sue also made the point that lifelong learning will prepare us to acquire new skills or knowledge we need to succeed. This is something that is important to me as a mother of twin sons who are currently in college and will be starting their careers soon. And something that I really enjoyed from the conversation with Sue is she reminded us that it is good to play with new technologies and that innovation is inspiring. Thanks again for joining. We hope you'll tune in for the next episode of The Power of Knowing.